We'll begin with the next session, which is being chaired by a very senior biochemist, Professor Lalit Mohan Srivastava, who is currently the consultant advisor in laboratory medicine at Sir Gangaram Kolmet Hospital in New Delhi. He's also the president of ACBI. He has been recipient of various awards, including Dr. B.C. Roy National Award by the Medical Council of India. To help him out, to co-chair the session, we have Dr. Balram Omar, who is an additional professor in the Department of Microbiology at the AIIMS Rishikesh. Over to Dr. Srivastava, sir, as well as Dr. Balram.
Good morning to all my panelists, my co-chairperson, Dr. Balram, and the participants. The first talk that I'm going to start is from Dr. Uma Kanga, who is a faculty member in the Department of Transplant Immunology and Immunogenetics, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. It's a pleasure to introduce one of our younger budding immunologists. And I think I take 1 or 2 minutes to tell that probably these are the years when the immunology was introduced in this country almost, it was 1968, 69, 70, when we had a couple of workshops, which was WHO, ICMR, AIIMS, combined workshops, from where in those workshops, 16 people from various specialties were trained in immunology, and in fact, all the immunology departments, starting from Srinagar to Madurai and from Calcutta to Mumbai, has all been established by those people who were trained during that period. And I think unfortunately, the large number of those 16 people are no more, but fortunately, I am one of them. Out of those who were trained during that period. So I think I have a very, very sensitive type of the feeling as far as the immunology and immunology techniques are concerned. And I think this is where I think the Dr. Uma Kanga, who is the progeny of one of those departments which are established after those workshops. Dr. Uma Kanga, she is a faculty member at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and she has, in fact, she has been working in the area of transplant immunology, genetic diversity of HLA genes, and molecular basis of the disease susceptibility. So, one of the things which I think I wish that she would be speaking, partly her own work also, because that's the one which I always think that should be done in one of these workshops where a particular work can also be done. Dr. Uma is also the secretary of the Indian Society of the Histocompatibility and Immunogenetics. She's also treasurer of the Indian Immunology Society. And this Indian Immunology Society was also established almost 50 years back. And she is managing presently as treasurer of the one. As I said, I happen to be president of this society, Indian Immunology Society, for 2 terms. One of the person who had trained Uma in her this department was also the president of the Indian Immunology Society. And I think therefore what I'm going to do just that a tribute to all those 16 people who were trained almost 50 years back and who went to their departments, started the Department of Immunology, both for the medical colleges as well as for the basic sciences in the universities. And I think I know from my experience that all those departments, starting from Srinagar to Madurai and from Calcutta to Mumbai, the different institutions, they are all doing extremely well. And as I said, Dr. Kanga is one of our budding faculty member of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and she has been working in this area of the transplant immunology and the immunogenetics for last 18 years or so at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. And I think I wish her all success, and therefore would like to listen to her. And I think we would like, our participants would like to listen to her and the work that is going on and how we are going to develop this. I think before I just close, I want to say that immunology is one area which is very, very close to most of us, both as a basic science, both as a clinical science, and as well as diagnostic sciences. So actually, 3-in-1. And that, therefore, I am very, very proud that this specialty is picking it up. It has picked up slowly, steadily, all along by 50 years. And I think the next 50 years will show. As I said, in 1969, what we only knew was about immunoglobulins, IgG, IgM, IgA, and so on. That was the one. The MD students used to do this immunoglobulins and submit a thesis for them. That was the time. And from there, coming to immunogenetics, transplantation immunology, and now vaccine developments, therefore, is a very, 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 very prelude of saying that this specialty would have to keep growing, would have to keep growing for the benefit of the science as well as for the human betterment. So Dr. Uma Kanga is going to speak today on the quality and standards for transplant immunology and immunogenetics. Dr. Kanga, welcome.
At the outset, good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for your kind words and giving everybody a background of immunology and in this country, how it started off. At the outset, I would like to also thank the organizers, especially Dr. Seema Bhargava from Gangaram Hospital, who actually gave me an opportunity to share my views on this platform. So I was assigned to speak on the quality and standards for a transplant immunology immunogenetics laboratory. And this specialty has been established in AIIMS by my mentor, Professor N.K. Mehra. It was somewhere in 70s that he started working on this specialty. I joined him as a PhD student in 90, and I've been trained by him and working in this premier institute that you see the picture. So I'm really proud to be part of fraternity. So I'm sure all of you are aware of that, you know, what all organs and tissues can be transplanted. So name an organ and somebody can donate and save somebody's life. So we have to be kind-hearted to donate. And that's how the organ donation goes, and we manage to save a lot of life. So in terms of solid organ transplant, you have seen all the organs picture, but for the bone marrow transplantation, I would like to mention that there are so many malignant and non-malignant disorders for which hematopoietic stem cell transplant is being done. It used to be previously called as bone marrow transplantation, but no longer now done as bone marrow. Majority of the diseases are treated by hematopoietic stem cells. The peripheral blood stem cells are taken. So there are rapid strides in the understanding the intricacies of transplant. But with all the advancement, we still have, you know, a lot of problems post-transplant, and we need to start working at a pre-transplant stage so that outcome of these transplants is really good. So one of the very important factors that is key for the transplant outcome is the genetic disparity between recipient and donor. So we need to match the recipient and donor's genes so that that impact of that matching is reflected in the outcome of a transplant. So, you know, like all of us know in Mahabharata, Arjuna was taught to be focused and, you know, teer jo hai wo eye of the fish pe rehna chahiye. And the same way people in the transplant immunology fraternity have been trained from the very beginning to just focus on this short arm of the chromosome 6. That is where the HLA genes are located. This is called the major histocompatibility complex. It has various classes of genes, and the very important factor, you know, that we must remember about this gene set is that it's very, very polymorphic genetic system. It is almost like a mini genome model where a lot of studies can be done. Why? Because these genes are immunologically relevant. They present the antigen, and that's how the immune response of any individual gears up. So be it infectious disease, be it transplantation, autoimmune diseases, these immune response genes are very, very critical. And therefore, because of the presentation of the antigen, they have a very important role, and they're crucial in the organ and stem cells transplantation scenario. So that's why we need to focus on this system. And the uniqueness that I told you, that this system is very polymorphic, you can see in this graph that at this present moment, maybe this number has even gone higher. This was last month when I looked at the database. There are close to 29,000 genes in this system that we have to identify. So we have to have a real good quality laboratory where we can assess all of these gene types and select a good donor for the recipient. So these MHC genes are actually translated, and as glycoproteins, they are expressed on cell surface. And these regions are where you see in the small figure here are the polymorphic regions, which are very, very you know, critical for presentation of the antigen. And that is where all the polymorphism lies. And we focus on these regions of the gene to be able to assign the HLA allele of any individual. In addition to transplantation, as I mentioned, a lot of diseases also are associated. These genes like HLA-B27, HLA-DQ, HLA-DR are associated with many autoimmune disorders. So we also, a transplant immunology laboratory has to cater to this diagnostic testing, where we look at the patients and screen them for the presence or absence of these genes. So before we do any talk on transplantation or the HLA region, I pay my homage to these three Nobel laureates, Baruch, Benisaraf, Jean Dossier, and George Snell, who actually are responsible and for, you know, bringing us into this field of transplant immunology, because they are the discoverers of these gene sets. And their contributions were awarded as a Nobel Prize in 1980. So I pay my homage to them. And also 10 years later, two more people were awarded the Nobel Prize for Medicine in 1990. And this is Sir Joseph Murray and Sir Don Bradman. Because of their contributions, Joseph Murray contributed to the organ transplant, and Sir Don Thomas contributed and established the bone marrow transplantation facility therapy for the patients. So these are worthy people who need to be acknowledged. And then in 6 years, another Nobel Prize was awarded to Peter Doherty and Rolf Zinkernagel, because they are the ones who had actually done the pioneering work in 1974, where they demonstrated that the antigen presentation is MHC restricted. So the role of MHC genes and MHC restriction was the work that contributed by these three people. And I must say, we are fortunate that many of these whom I showed the pictures visited India, many immunology meetings and our department, and we had the opportunity to interact with them. So now coming to the theme of the symposia today, I was assigned to talk on the quality assurance in transplant immunology. So I think all of you are well aware, if we talk of what is quality and why we need to have quality in a medical laboratory, how do we ensure this quality? What are these ISO standards 15189? Most of you are aware. What is the certification or the accreditation? So basically, we are creating a practical tool for managing the quality and competence in a medical laboratory. So this is applied to all the medical laboratories, nothing unique to a transplant immunology laboratory. But I must mention that when we talk of quality, it's quite a complex notion. And you know, different people have different things to say, and many vague definitions sometimes come up. People say quality is not an act. You know, these are, you know, you do just things right the first time. So quality are the tools, and then it's, you know, it's kind of perception that it's just an approach, it's a value for money. But then one needs to know that what is quality? Quality is always associated to some object. And in medical laboratories, it is not an object, it's not just coffee, it's many things that we need to focus on. So in a medical laboratory, what we need to do is that we need to do this testing very carefully. Why? Because these testings are the ones which are responsible, these reports on the clinical specimen are responsible that they can help the health of a patient, and pertaining, because they are pertaining to the diagnosis, treatment, and prevention of diseases. And also 70% of you know, the clinical medicine decision depends on these you know, investigations that a medical laboratory reports. So obviously it's a highly complex operation, and one needs to be absolutely accurate, you know, maintain confidentiality, time effectiveness, and you know, cost effectiveness has to be also maintained. So in medical laboratories, these ISO certifications are done. And I would just like to mention here one thing that, you know, what is an accreditation process that we think of? So there is a management system that we need to look at. There is a technical competence that we need to look at. And when we talk of accreditation, it is in the interest of the competent laboratories that, you know, their competence is verified through a process of inspection. And then we confirm with a good standing. And it is also in the interest of patients, of society and governments, and the medical labs operate with very high standards and have the technical competence to do it. So it's not a, you know, accreditation is not like a guarantee. It's an evaluation of the competency basically that one needs to keep in mind. Not only just the management system, the competency of the laboratory. All of you are aware that, you know, there are several requirements, the management requirements and also the technical requirements. And I'm not going to go into details of all this because I have been assigned to talk today on transplant immunology and immunogenetics. And I will come back to the HLA system that I started off with, that it, this polygenic system and polymorphic system has many, many gene types. And we need to focus that all of these gene types are assigned in any individual that is tested. And there are a lot of variations in one individual, from one individual to another. If you look at this picture, the lower half shows you, you know, two chromosomes, the chromosome 6, the MHC region, where all the HLA loci are same on both the chromosomes. So it's a homozygous individual with very few, only 6 type of different HLA genes or HLA proteins on their cell surface. Whereas if you look the top half of the slide, you will see that both the chromosomes have variable types of MHC genes. And these genes, when transcribed to proteins, there can be a max of 18 different types of HLA alleles on the cell surface of this particular individual. So we have to be very, very critical in doing the assay so that we are able to assign all of these alleles absolutely, absolutely perfectly, so that a recipient donor who are undergoing a transplant have the best outcome of all the efforts done by the medical fraternity in doing the transplant. So there can be, you know, a transplant immunology laboratory can have a wide scope, and a lot of things are being done in a transplant immunology laboratory. For example, if there's a laboratory catering to a live-related or a live-unrelated program, laboratory could be catering to a deceased donor transplantation where the cadaver kidneys or cadaver organs are available. It could be an HLA matched transplantation. It could be an HLA, you know, half match or haploidentical transplantation, or it could be a matched unrelated stem cell transplantation wherein the laboratory has to have a lot of investigations and quality depending on the program that they are catering to. So the variety of tests are being done in any transplant immunology. To name a few, I have highlighted over here. It could be HLA typing by either serology or molecular. And these could be complement dependent assays, or they could be molecular assays using either sequence specific primers or sequence specific oligoprobes or direct sequencing or next generation sequencing. The other assays that are done prior to solid organ transplantations are cross-match. Here we try to detect the anti-donor antibody status of a recipient, and it's a cross-match positivity is a contraindication for a transplant. So it's a very, very essential test, and it is done by complement-mediated assay, or it can be enhanced using AHA, or it can be done using a flow cytometry. One can detect both IgG and IgM antibodies. And recently, we also can do a virtual cross-match wherein just the background information of the sensitization of a recipient can tell us how we can predict the outcome of a transplant or a cross-match instance. We do need to monitor the recipient. If the recipient is sensitized due to either pregnancy or due to blood transfusions or due to prior transplants, then we need to see whether the recipient has any antibody that can impact the graft that is going to be placed. So we need to screen for the antibodies, whether they are present or absent. We need to check what is the panel of antibodies that is observed in case it's a positive, whether there are class 1 antibodies or class 2, what is the percentage of antibody, and then we need to assign the specificity to the antibody, whether that antibody is a donor specific or it is a non-donor specific. So all different kind of antibody monitoring needs to be performed by a transplant immunology laboratory. Now, this monitoring of a transplant is also done pre-transplant as well as in post-transplant scenario, because we need to see whether the patient is sensitized so we can reduce the load of antibodies. The clinicians can give IVIG or rituximab or wait for a time when the antibody goes down and do a transplant. And sometimes the antibodies would develop post-transplant. So we also need to keep an eye after the transplant that how the patient's immune system is handling the allogenicity generated due to the graft. And in stem cell transplants, when we do a mismatch transplants, we do monitor the antibodies. And also post-transplant, molecular monitoring is done using chimerism assays, which I'll take you through in further slides. In addition to all of these, the HLA laboratory caters to all of these HLA disease associations. These genes are presence or absence of these genes are screened, and the laboratory needs to have established assays which can identify exactly the gene that we are looking for so that the diagnosis can be made by the clinicians. In addition to that, HLA laboratories also perform identification of, screening for presence of certain genes that can lead to hypersensitivity. For example, a patient of HIV, if he has to be given abacavir, presence of B5701 can be very, very harmful and the patient can be lost. Similarly, carbamazepine, a drug where the B1502 presence can be harmful. And there are several such genes that we need to identify for, pharmacogenomic assays. So the transplant immunology laboratory has many things to handle, and I will take you through how they are handling. In terms of transplantation of the human organs, every transplant laboratory in India has to abide by this Human Transplant Organ Act, which was approved by the Government of India in 1994 and has been, periodically revised. And presently, a gazette notification, the latest one came up in 2014. And this is the gazette notification which highlights all the rules and regulations governing a related transplant, an unrelated transplant, family, close relative transplant, different kinds of hospital establishments, what are their roles, what are the roles and responsibility of clinicians, what is the role of the laboratory is highlighted in this Transplant Act. And to just tell you that in terms of the transplant immunology laboratory, the laboratory is responsible for doing the genetic matching between the recipient and donor. And an accredited laboratory has to perform this testing. And what the Act says that if it's an unrelated or if it's, if the genetic relationship cannot be established, then the transplant should not be done. If the documentation are not able to clearly indicate that what the relationship is, then the laboratory must perform assays to establish this relationship of the recipient and the donor. And only then can the transplant go ahead. And The laboratories need to sign this Form 5, which is defined in the Act, that the laboratory certifies the genetic relationship. Now, there is a bit of controversy that this HLA system is actually not to be used for genetic relationship establishment. Nevertheless, most of the HLA laboratories do issue a certificate, but there are issues that are being discussed that unless we do a family study, we are not able to establish the genetic relationship. So when we are doing only one recipient and a donor, ideally other genetic markers like fingerprinting and all should be done to be able to issue this form 5. So to be able to be so precise in the testing, every laboratory has to establish many, many HLA typing assays. And then, starting from serology-based to molecular-based, most laboratories in India have moved on and established very many assays from serology to PCR SSO to Luminex and next generation sequencing. So we always need to keep up, updating ourselves, what are the advancements in the technology and doing the assay. So for doing these assays, a laboratory has to have a certain infrastructure. And I would like to give you an overview that the laboratory must have a certain defined way of functioning. And so, so laboratories need to have an area where the samples can be collected, then the DNA extraction can be performed, or also the serology assays can be performed. And then to another section where, the PCR can be performed. Following that is the post-transplant, post-PCR room where the Luminex-based or post-PCR hybridization assays can be performed. And then a room where the analysis can be done. So we need to have a segregated area for serological assays, for pre-assessment of the samples, for the PCR and the post, as well as for the analysis. And there has to be a certain way in a direction in which the samples and individuals can go in and come out of the laboratory. So all of these need to be kept in mind when a transplant immunology laboratory is functioning so that there is no cross-contamination between the samples. So to give a more clearer view here, for example, you have an area where the samples are collected, and you have a safety cabinet where the DNA extraction can be done, then a clean room where the PCR can be done, and then a third area where the post-PCR environment is there, and then walk out of the laboratory in that direction. And these are views of some international laboratory that I will show you. This is from my last year visit to Stanford laboratory where Dr. Marcello's lab. You have to have enough space in the lab to move around all the PCR machines in one location, the deep freezers in one location. Marcello organized this very well. And therefore the laboratories can have, really good environment to work. So these establishments need to be developed in such a way that the lab environment is clean. For example, here you see a woman performing the electrophoresis, a biosafety hood, and everything has to be very clean. So this is a laboratory in India where, again, I'm showing you that this is the lab where they are doing the CDC cross-match. This is the pre-amplification room on the left bottom. On the right bottom is the post-amplification room. So we need to have segregated areas, segregated instruments, paper, pipettes. Each and every thing utilized in the lab need to be kept in a segregated way. And why we need to do is that because we need to perform these assays. So I'll take you through now the assays that we perform and what is crucial to remember in these assays for maintaining the quality. This is, I also would like to acknowledge Paul Terasaki, who actually, he is no more, and he's the one who in 1964, established this, the first technology, serology-based complement mediated cytotoxicity assay, which is called micro lymphocytotoxicity. And you see on the right side, there is a plate, a tray, plastic tray, which has very minute wells. And this is named on him. It's called a Terasaki plate, which all HLA transplant immunology labs use. This is the tray where we perform the assays, the serology based assay. So basically, we take the lymphocytes of an individual, use the antibodies and use a complement mediated assay where, a complex is formed on the cell surface and we can observe, like in the lower bottom of this slide, you can see the lysis of the cells. So whenever you find a complementary HLA antibody only in those particular wells of the plate, you will find the positive reaction as observed in the in this lower bottom, which can either be observed using a dye, using dye, or we can use the fluorescent dye and observe in the microscope. So when we are doing this assay, the laboratory needs to titrate the complement, needs to have an appropriate assay of the cell concentration and the antibody that needs to be dispensed in the plate. And then The observation, which is a bit subjective over here, but needs to be very carefully observed, that whether we have any lysis or we don't have any lysis, so that we can assign the HLA allele of that age. Okay, so I'll quickly take you forward. That these are different extended family settings that we can do the testing. But when an individual has a different gene set which is unique to Indians, for example, here if I show you, these gene sets are compared to the Japanese and Caucasians are very unique. So then we are finding very difficult to find an unrelated donor. And we need to do the antibody monitoring. So there are different assays to do the antibody. Either we can do the cross-matching using CDC or flow cytometry, where we separate the T and B cells and use the the positive controls and negative controls, look at the shift in the mean fluorescence and do a cross-match. This is the role of a transplant immunology laboratory, where the flow cytometry, gating and issues have to be taken care of very carefully. And we assess the shift in the mean shift in the channel to say that the cross-match is positive or negative. Further, we go on doing the antibody assessment. The laboratory needs to keep in mind the cross-reactive antibodies and then able to predict the, based on the public and private epitopes of the HLA alleles, that what are the donor-specific antibodies an individual has. So unless we perform a high-resolution testing of the donor, we are not able to see, for example, here we observe the antibody to these alleles, but unless we have a high-resolution typing of the donor, we cannot say they are the donor-specific antibodies. So all these assays need to be performed in the transplant immunology laboratory. And for the stem cell transplant, post-transplant, we need to perform the chimerism assays, which is to assess how much of the stem cell is engrafted into the recipient. There can be a scenario where there is a mixture of recipient and donor cells, and these can be assessed at the molecular level. So what are the recipient genotypes and the donor genotypes, whether the patient is engrafting the donor type of stem cells or not. So these are molecular assays which we do on sequencer, where we can assess the so many STR markers, that how, which STR markers can be informative in recipient donor pair and can be used as a monitoring tool post-transplant. So after the monitoring, we also have to, you know, see that our lab is performing well, participate from the very beginning in a QC exercise. And in transplant immunology laboratory, it can be any academic degree individual has, whether a PhD or an MD, but the person needs to be competent to assess and monitor these assays. So a 4-year training in transplant immunology histocompatibility is mandatory. It can be 2 years in general immunology, 2 years in histocompatibility. This is the experience required for any person with a clinical or a non-clinical academic background. And we need to have all of these parameters in check, whether it's the complement, it's the cell viability, the controls, and whether the assays are being performed at different temperatures, whether it is, you know, flow cytometry, the antibodies are titrated or not, the instrument is, you know, calibrated or not. In molecular assays, I already mentioned to you, post-transplant as well. So all of these proficiency testing protocols and programs take care that of how the laboratory is performing. And the EQAS programs are run for the transplant immunology in various parts of the globe, be it America, you know, Europe, UK, Germany, France, Asia, and in India. We have the EQAS programs where the transplant immunology laboratories can participate. And it's nothing new. It's all of this proficiency testing started in 1940s, where, you know, you see one of the papers in 47, where it was the laboratories participating in the calcium levels. And this publication came from Dr. Sondermann. And it's not a new, the history is there, that the quality assessment was always being done. In HLA, transplant immunology field, it started in 70s. And then initially used to be trying to identify HLA gene types in global population. And later on, to monitor and improve the quality. Presently, all the EQAS programs, inter-laboratory quality assessments are done to see whether how the persons are performing day to day. And these assays are being used for not only for QC, for routine quality measures also. And idea is that we have a continuous improvement program, improve in the measurements, in our analytical competence, in the training of the personnel, in the instrument validation. All of these need to be maintained. And I would read the statement from Dr. Sondermann saying, maintenance of high standards of analysis not only serves as scientific stimulus for the lab, but it's also of direct benefit to the patient. So keeping the patient in mind, people do publish the proficiency testing program results from different labs, have a well-defined program, invite labs and organize when the samples are going to be sent, when the results are expected, how they have to report, and then doing what you say you are doing and being able to prove it gets you a certificate, and most laboratories or EQUAS programs will certify that one has participated in the laboratory. So when we are doing a serology-based assay, this is how we assign the allele we write in HLA-A2. But when we move on to molecular assays, which I will show you in a short duration, we, you know, the nomenclature of assigning an allele changes to A*02, and it could go on further with a colon in between on an intermediate resolution or a high resolution. And as we go further, I will explain what it means. So this is the HLA nomenclature that we currently follow, that we write the HLA allele, use a hyphen, and mention the locus, whether it is an HLA A, B, C, DR locus. And then we put a separator as a star, and then put the gene name, the allele. Then we have a colon as a field separator, and then we have the 101 is kind of a gene type of HLA A2. So we have, you know, these colons in between to separate the fields. And this is the specific protein 101 that we are of the HLA A2. And then we have the third field and the fourth field, which explain the synonymous or the, you know, differences in the non-coding region of the HLA allele. So the more the resolution we increase of a testing, the number of the fields go from 2 to, you know, 1 to 2, 3 and 4 field. So the 4 field is actually the highest resolution that we can go. And this is the basic technique, the molecular technique that we use. Herein we use, you know, specific primers for any HLA allele, and we run an electrophoresis. Every sample will be assessed during the electrophoresis. There would be an internal control. And to check that the assay is going fine, we must have an internal control band in every well. And the particular allele presence will be reflected by the allele bands in this. And I will show you some images. For example, this is an image on the top of an HLA B transition screening gel, where we use a positive control. This, the rightmost is the ladder, the molecular weight ladder. Then there is a positive control, then there is a negative control, and on the left are all the assays from 1 to 8. And we need to have these, you know, negative and a positive control in the PCR to check whether the assay is going good. At the bottom, you see a gel, wherein on the linear line, you see a lot of bands in every well, that is the internal control. And we must have the presence of internal control to say that the PCR is done well. And the specific bands you see at the bottom are the allele bands which help us assign the allele. This is another gel of a different protocol. Here we moved on to the Luminex-based protocol, wherein we amplify not the allele, we amplify the locus of the HLA gene set. We amplify an HLA A or B or C, and we amplify the two exons in the class 1 region, exon 2 and 3, and therefore we see two bands. For some of the wells where you see a single band is a poorer quality, and we must omit this from further assays to be done. And this is how we assess that the amplification is going good. And then we move on to do the reverse SSO-based assays, either using the histospot kind of a machine, wherein we have a chip in the well, and all the probes are immobilized on the chip. And we can also use the Luminex-based assay, wherein the fluorochrome beads have multiple probes and multiple beads are present. And the amplified DNA goes and binds to these beads. And using a software, we are able to assign the allele. So we need to have a lot of quality checks right from PCR to post-PCR so that, you know, the allele assignments are absolutely accurate. We move on further with the technology, and if we go to sequencing. So this is a gel where, you know, large regions of the MHC, HLA A, B, C, DR, DQ have been amplified for 4 samples. And you see that we need to compare the size of the amplicon to be very precise as per the ladder. And only then we move forward for doing the sequencing. And these are the automated sequences that we use. And this is the kind of sequence that is generated in a very, very clean manner when it is handled very carefully with all the quality measures. And sometimes if we do not have appropriate quality measures, these peaks that you see different colors, nucleotide, there would be overlaps and one will not be able to distinguish the heterozygous positions clearly, and we will end up in ambiguities. So you can see here that the arrow I have pointed down to a heterozygous position, it is a very clean heterozygous position. So here in sequencing, we are doing one sequence in the forward direction and one in reverse. So many times the two different alleles would have one position as heterozygous, and in this sequencing, we are able to exactly identify. However, we still face sometimes problems that two HLA alleles can lead to same, heterozygosity at a particular position, like you see over here, that these two alleles have GC and AT in two different conformations. And we can still, you know, after doing sequencing also land up with an ambiguity, whether it is a B735O3 or it is a B735 different subtype. So we need to have even more refined technology where such ambiguities can also be lost. So rather than sequencing only once in two directions, we can also do sequencing of multiple fragments and multiple times. And this is what is the technology called next generation sequencing, where we amplify several exons. We break them into minor parts, minor regions of the DNA, and then each of the strand is sequenced multiple times, maybe a few hundred times, so that you have the confidence that the read depth is so high, so deep that we are absolutely confident that every region, what is the sequence. So we don't land up in those HLA ambiguities that we land up with the Sanger sequencing. We can also have technologies where you can read the whole sequence, whole MHC region in one go, but it is a really very expensive assay. So in MHC region, we have these kind of fragments, and these heterozygosity that I showed you in the sequencing or Sanger sequencing are taken care of when we do a next generation sequencing, because each of these fragments is sequenced hundreds of times, and we are absolutely confident what is the location or what is the nucleotide at that particular region. Here again, when we are doing the amplifications, if we have a proper quality measure, you see the lower bottom gel from our lab, absolutely clean amplification, each region of the MHC amplified very well as compared to the lateral. Whereas if you see on the top portion, some of the wells, you don't see the clean amplification, and that's because the quality has been compromised, either in the PCR or in the DNA extraction or in the, running the electrophoresis gel. So one needs to maintain this quality so that you can do sequencing and using all these multiple platforms, any of the platform, we can do the next generation sequencing and assign the alleles. So we move on from a serology nomenclature of assigning an HLA-A2 protein on cell surface to a molecular assay where we can either do HLA-O2. If we do a further typing, we can come to the second field, and we know that it is a 0-1 type of an O2 allele. And also we can define the non-coding region and outside coding regions, wherein we can go to the fourth field using the sequencing, next generation sequencing assay. So what are we looking at? For example, I'm telling you, this is a family wherein this is a patient. You see the gloomy face of the patient. He is looking for a donor. We have performed the HLA typing of the whole family. The parents' HLA genes are written in different colors. So these genes are inherited en bloc, it is a set. So we have only four sets of genes in every family. And every child will get one set of gene is inherited from father and one set of gene from mother. So what we are looking for is if this is a patient who has inherited the red gene set from father and a blue gene set from mother, he needs to have a donor for a stem cell transplantation who has inherited exactly the same gene set. So in solid organ, we can do a mismatch transplant. And that mismatching allogenicity can be taken care by immune, the drugs, like immunosuppressive drugs like cyclosporine, tacrolimus. Whereas in bone marrow transplantation, the ideal scenario is that we need to have a 100% matched individual from a family or an unrelated individual if there is no family donor, but they should match for all the MHC genes that the patient has. All of these quality assurance is very relevant in a biology. It has significance in terms of transplant program, pharmacogenomics, disease association, diversity studies, even MHC-based vaccination studies. And therefore, I would like to end over here by saying my thanks to for everybody for the patient hearing. And I do hope that the chairperson finds information of relevant quality and approves this presentation that I was able to convey in part, at least how a transplant immunology laboratory has to ensure the quality. And I thank the organizers once again for the opportunity. Thank you.